맡은 너무 뒤. 지금 해결할 때.
해결할 때 다음.
Alright. Hi guys. Okay. Hi guys. Well, welcome back to my channel. For those of you who are new, my name is Kile. Okay, maybe I should do this again.
Yeah.
Guys, welcome back to my channel. For those of you who are new, thank you so much for joining me. Yeah. I have not done a sit-down video in about 6 months, so I am still familiarizing myself with just sitting down in front of the camera and, you know, speaking in a formal manner. But yes, if you are new here, please do not forget to subscribe. I promise you, you're going to love it here. And if you are a returning subscriber, thank you so much for watching this video. So in today's video, we are going to be discussing the road to becoming a doctor in South Africa. I have gotten like quite a few DMs. I know you guys like coming for people when they say I've gotten a lot of DMs. Listen, I've gotten quite a few DMs, okay? And a lot of them are students still in high school or first year, second year university students in different degrees, whereby these people are saying that, hey Kile, listen, I want to become a gynecologist one day, I want to become a cardiologist one day, what is the road to that? And so I thought, okay, let me make a video on just to explain the whole process of getting into medical school, getting through medical school, being a doctor, and what happens after you are now a medical doctor. So if you do enjoy this video, please give it a like, and also please comment down below if there are any other videos that you guys would like me to do in terms of discussions. I would absolutely love to engage with you guys on those. So yeah, let's get into the video. Firstly, I just want to start off by saying that anybody can apply into medical school, right? As a matric student, you are applying into medical school. There are obviously certain requirements that the university has set in their prospectus as the minimum requirements. For a lot of those, it is physics, it is maths, some universities it is biology, but I do know that biology or life sciences is not compulsory with all universities, and they would set their minimum requirements at an average of maybe 60%, 60 to 69%, 70%. You meeting the university's minimum requirements does not necessarily mean that you will be accepted, because what happens is that they're saying, in order for us to look at your application, in order for us to consider your application, this is the bare minimum of what you need to have had, right? So you could be going in there with a 70% in most of your subjects and not get into medical school because, firstly, there is a limited number of space. Secondly, so many people apply into medical school, so many people who have gotten 90s, okay, 80s, and this is not to put pressure on anybody. This is just to make people aware that just because you meet the minimum requirements, it does not mean that you will get in. If anything, it is just for the universities to be able to say, okay, we got 5,000 applications, for an example, for medicine, and only 3,000 of those applications met our minimum requirements. Then from that 3,000, they need to take the top 200 or 250. But it could happen that your average is probably like 75 76 77, and you don't get in only because maybe the 250 spots were already filled up. And so apply into medical school as a university student who maybe you're in your first, second, third year, and you would then apply with obviously your matric results, but you would also add in your transcript, and there would be a different criteria that the university is judging you on. So they won't only judge you on your matric marks, they will also look at your transcript, whether it's in your first year, second year, third year, it does not matter. Even with that, there is a certain criteria for university students. And then you can also apply into medical school as a graduate who is holding a degree, whether it is an undergrad degree, honors degree, a master's degree, or even a PhD, you will do your application. Another thing that I wanted to mention was that if you are a graduate and you're thinking of applying into medicine, there is no specific degree that these universities look at. As far as I know, you can apply into medicine with any degree. I know people who have done a BA in journalism. I know people who have done, obviously, a PhD in science. I know myself, for one, I did my first degree in oral health sciences. And I know people who have come from the commercial field, so they've done a BCom in something. Listen, you do not need to have done a specific, like, there is no specific degree that you that can increase the chances of you getting in for medicine. Of course, if you do a degree in health sciences or in science, it does give you some sort of benefit because you are have been exposed to working with patients, you've been exposed to the hospital environment, you may have also been exposed to certain modules and subjects that when you get into medicine you'll be able to familiarize yourself with them easier. But also, like I'm saying, if you are not in one of those, like if you're not in a health science degree or in a science degree, it does not necessarily decrease your chances of getting in. It just means that you're just going to have to buckle up and work a bit harder. Essentially, what I'm trying to say is that you can get into medicine with any degree, as long as it's a degree. With graduates, there is also a certain number of requirements, or there is a certain criteria that they usually judge students on. I remember when I was applying in 2019, I saw a video on YouTube that said that you need to look at the faculty handbook. It's called a faculty handbook, and it has got, it is more detailed than prospectus. So it will tell you, the university will state that this is the amount of students that we're considering who are coming from matric. This is the amount of seats we have reserved for people who have degrees. This is the amount of seats we have reserved for people who are doing transfers. And this is also the basic or the minimum requirements that we will require from graduates as well as students who are doing a transfer. It differs for each and every university, but if you go to the university website and you type in, for an example, I remember, I think I saw it with the UFS, it was the University of Free State Health Science faculty handbook. You download it, it will give you so much information about the admission requirements and why they'll consider this person and not this person. And I do also just want to say that yes, race does come into play in South Africa, and there are different standards that are set. I'm not too sure how those standards, like what those standards are, but I am well aware that a white male applying into medical school and a black female applying into medical school are not judged on the same criteria. I do have to put that out there. Right, there's different programs that you can apply for in South Africa. The most common one is the six-year program, which is offered across all universities except for the University of Free State. The University of Free State has got a five-year degree program, so their MBCHB is 5 years. Every other medical school in South Africa has got the six-year degree program, and one or two medical schools vary. Maybe they'll have like an additional program or an extended program. For an example, Sefako Makgato Health Sciences University has got the extended program, which is 7 years instead of 6 years. So they've got the six-year program, and then they also have the seven-year program. I think with the seven-year program, it's that when you are in the seven-year program, you do maths and science and biology. You just do it for a longer period, and then once you're done with that 1 year, you then get added into that six-year medicine class. And then with FITS, they have got the graduate entry medical program, which is specifically for people who have done a minimum of 3 years in a degree. You cannot get into GEMP if you are a first year, second year. No, you need to have at least have done 3 years and or graduated in an undergrad degree. And they also, I think, require you to have biology, physics, and chemistry at first year university level in order for you to be considered. With the GEMP program, it is then 4 years of medicine. So you will do the MBBCH program in 4 years. Obviously, it is a delight, absolutely, but you need to keep in mind that you have to have been a graduate, or you have to have done a minimum of 3 years of an undergrad degree. Then, say now you've applied to one of those programs, you will then wait for your response, and then you get into medical school. Once you are in medical school, the curriculums across all medical schools differ. But at the end of the day, because the HPCSA, which is the council body for health professionals, they have got a certain criteria that needs to be checked off at the end of medical school. So sometimes with other medical schools, they could start being practical and seeing patients already from first year. Other medical schools, the students only start seeing patients in third year. It differs for each and every medical school, but at the end of your medical degree, you would have done everything that is required. For example, if you were to come to tax, we do basic sciences in the first 6 months. So that is your philosophy, psychology, your chemistry, your biology, your physics. We do that in the first 6 months. And then after the first 6 months, we move on to doing basic medical sciences. So that is your embryology, your osteology, your, what are those things? The histology, basic anatomy, basic physiology, and then we build on it. In your second year, you will then be building on your physiology, your anatomy. You not do it in detail, but you do it only for like maybe 3 months. You do anatomy for 3 months, you do physiology for 3 months. We've got immunology, microbiology, pathology, you know, like there's just a whole lot of other things that you're just building your knowledge on. Whereas compared to a curriculum like VITS, you will do chemistry, physics, I think maths as well, I'm not too sure. You will do it for the whole year in first year. And then in second year, you will basically do anatomy, physiology, and molecular medicine the whole of second year. And then only in third year do you start looking at systems on their own. So cardio, pulmonology, abdomen, and so on and so forth. Like I'm saying, each university has got a different curriculum. However, at the end of the degree, you would have known what you need to know. It's also broken up into what I think is your non-clinical years or your preclinical years and your clinical years. Your non-clinical years, that's basically where you're just learning everything. Like you're learning the physiology, you're learning how the body works, you're learning to, okay, if there's a disease, this is what's going to happen in the disease, or this is what's going to happen with the body rather. Clinical years, I guess now you're more focused on, we're now studying the disease, we're learning how to manage the disease, you're learning how to diagnose the disease. That's what you do in your clinical years. Your clinical years are also where you now start actually interacting with patients, you start working on patients, and you are in the hospital more, you start being in the hospital more and more and more and more. By the time you're in final year, you spend very little or no time at all in class, and you basically get your tutorials and maybe any lectures that you may have in the hospital. Obviously with COVID things have changed, you will get it online, but essentially once you are done with your non-clinical or your preclinical years, you then go into your clinical years where you are more in the hospital and you are applying everything that you have learned. So let's say now you were learning about ectopic pregnancy, the theory of ectopic pregnancy. You are now able to see an ectopic pregnancy. You will know what to do when someone presents with an ectopic pregnancy. Then after the either 4 years of the GEMP program, the 5 years if you're at UFS, the 6 years, which is most medical universities, medical schools, or the 7 years, which is the extended program. After those years, you are now then going to be called a doctor. You get your doctor title, and we are all so proud of you. After getting that doctor title, it is a requirement by the South African government that you do 3 years. My parents called them, I think they were called the Zuma years. I don't know why they called them the Zuma years. But my parents described it as the Zuma years. I guess like previous older generations, that's how they described it. But basically, these 3 years are mandatory. So you do not have a choice. After you graduate medical school, you have to apply to work at a in a state hospital. There's like a whole lot of options to choose from different hospitals in the country. And basically, these 3 years comprise of 2 years internship and 1 year comp serve. When you do the 2 years of internship, you are basically a junior doctor. You are still working under supervision. You're still being taught how things work. Like, yes, you have learned this in medical school, but it's a possibility that you've never seen it in real life. Or even if you have seen it, it is to basically finesse your skills and make sure that you know how to manage.
I've heard from a few people saying that the first year of internship, it is a lot. The gap between being a medical student and being a medical doctor, it is a lot, especially obviously in South Africa, in the public healthcare system. It tests you, but it's a lot, like you get through it. So that is the first 2 years you would be an intern. So the disciplines that you've rotated through in medical school when you started your clinical years, you will do peds, you will do surgery, you will do internal medicine, you will do obs and gyne, all those disciplines. You then do them again when you are an intern. And then in your CompServe, I am not too sure what the role of a CompServe doctor is, but I do know that you're no longer now a junior doctor. You now can do and manage certain cases on your own. So I would just like to mention that when you are doing your internship, you are not going to do your internship and your CompServe at the same place. You have to reapply to be placed elsewhere. Sometimes you can do it at the same place, but it's very rare that you do it at the same place. And also, you only start getting paid when you graduate. So when they give you that doctor title and you start your internship, that is when you start getting paid. Medical students do not get paid. Like, yes, the medical student will be on call and they will be learning how to manage patients, or they'll be managing and helping to manage the patient. But for the mere fact that you are still studying, you are not going to be getting paid. You will only start getting paid after the 6 years of medical school. That is when you start getting paid. Now you are done with your 3 years. That is a mandatory requirement from the government. What will then happen is that you get the title of an independent practitioner. This then allows you to either, if you decide that you want to leave clinical medicine entirely and you want to maybe go into corporate, you are allowed to do that. If you decide that you want to rather go into the private sector and you want to work either for a private hospital, or you want to open up your own private practice, you are also allowed to do that. And if you decide that you want to stay in the government space, you can also do that. And this is when we now say you are, you know, the GPs, you are a general practitioner, you are a general doctor. Patients come to you, you are the first contact with a patient. You have the first contact with a patient. They will come to you for all sorts of things, be it flu, pains, doctor, I'm pregnant. You are the first person that they come to. Then if you see that, okay, this particular problem or this particular presentation of a disease is beyond my scope of practice as a general practitioner, that is when you will then write a referral letter to a specialist. You have to come back into the government's circuit. So you need to come back and work for the government and get a post in that specific discipline that you want to specialize. Post opens up and they say that they are looking for registrars and this is the discipline that you want to be in. Let's say you've decided, okay, I want to become a gynecologist or I don't know, a general surgeon. You have to wait for a post to be available and then you will then apply for that post. Different departments and different disciplines have got different requirements. Like I know with a lot of anesthesiologists posts, they require you to have already done a diploma in anesthesiology. Some disciplines even say if you have done your primaries in this discipline, then it is also an added advantage. So there are certain requirements in order for you to get that reg post. Once you get into the reg post, the registrarship post, it can either take between three or four years up until 6-7 years for you to specialize. Obviously, once again, different specialities have got different requirements. I know with an example, anesthesiology is 4 years. I know gynae, I think, is also 4 or 5 years. General surgery is also 4-5 years, but they've got different requirements in order for you to be able to get in. So sometimes you could even like take 2 or 3 years getting into, like you could take maybe 2-3 years to get into that specific program, maybe because there are no posts, so because you need to first fulfill the prerequisites in order for you to get in to study for the 4-5-6-7 years. And then once you are done with those 4-5-6-7 years, which include theoretical components, then the practical components, like if you have a registrar post, you are working as a doctor, of course, in that specific department. However, you are also a student, so you will be getting paid and you'll be studying at the same time. It is very hectic. Like, from the registrars that I have spoken to, reg time is a lot of work. It takes a lot of dedication because you're now basically back in medical school, but you're also working as a doctor. And then only after that 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe 7 years, then you are a specialist. So for an example, if you were to say want to become a gynecologist, for an example, you would do the 6 years of medicine, you would do the 3 years that is mandatory from the government, and then if you are lucky and you get a post immediately after your comsurf, which isn't so common actually, because like I said, certain departments require you maybe to have a year of experience in that specific field or in that specific department, right? That's already like 9 years before you can even get the post. And then let's say they require you to have like 1 year experience, then you would have, that's 10 years. And then once you get the reg post, it would be maybe like 4, maybe 5 years for some other people. And in total, that would be about 15 years for you to become a specialist. That's an average amount of years once again. Some people have done it in a shorter time, I think, but like I'm saying, that's just the average amount of years that is required for you to become a specialist. So if you still want to become a gynecologist, or you want to become, I don't know, a neurosurgeon with neurosurgery, I don't know how long that takes. I know it's a very strenuous and very long program. But for an example, the four-year reg programs that a lot of people go for, it takes about 15 years from the time you start medical school up until you finish with your reg post. I hope that you guys found this video to be informative, and please do give it a thumbs up if you found it informative. Not index finger up, thumbs up. If you found it informative, I will see you guys in my next video. Thank you so much for watching and getting to this point.